5, 4, 3.
She's pure alligator. Pure white.
2.
Albinos that do make it to reproductive age can't find a mate because they look funny.
1.
Albino affairs.
Thank you, Dr. Welsing. Anybody who, if you are listening, I had thought of that. So if you had to explain to someone, what the world, WTH, what does a pale raven or a pale rodent, what does that have to do with racism? All the things that happen in the world, why are you all wasting time on a regular basis to scrutinize or focus on, you know, a segment on an albino rodent? How would you all explain, or maybe if you don't think it's relevant, you can share that too, but how would you articulate that to a non-white person, how, why that relates to white supremacy racism, why that is even important, noteworthy? What would you say? Think on that one. I've been...
I was going to answer.
Let's hear it. Let's hear it.
Well, I just think it's important because obviously white people think that people with different racial classifications should be treated differently. You know, white people should have the least amount of mistreatment, and the darker you are, the more mistreatment you're subject to. So I think it is fascinating to see how they also do that with animals, because they look at these albino animals, these white animals, like they look at themselves in a way. So the way they think white animals should be treated is the way they think white people should be treated, and that is well.
Context of white supremacy. Gusty Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Wednesday, February 7, 2024. So I have been told. Okie dokie. The University of Washington, white people are not ignorant about racism, white supremacy, and they have lots of resources to bring in speakers to share information, details on all sorts of subject matter. I've told folks, you know, be alert. If you live in an area where you're close to a community college, major university, college institution, go check out. You can just go look online. You can look on your phone. They should have a calendar with events that are coming up. If they're going to have speakers, authors, professors, or what have you, visiting from other institutions, other parts of the world sometimes, many times, colleges, universities, even local libraries and bookstores, they will have these sort of events, and they will be free and open to the public. You can attend. This is one of the ways that you can find nonfiction books to read and study about white supremacy racism. This is certainly an opportunity where you can go and ask questions. If you have offspring, you can go with your offspring so that they can see you asking questions about the most serious problem in the world, the system of white supremacy racism. And Black History Month especially, take advantage. And I don't mean poetry. I think I said nonfiction, right? I don't mean like poetry and we're going to do kente cloth and that sort of thing. No disrespect to people who do that, but I mean something serious where we're talking in a serious manner about the problem of white supremacy racism. To that end, wowee, we talked about and had the segment Albino Affairs on this program for years. We've talked with Dr. Frances Cress Welsing about albinism and how this applies to her theory of white genetic annihilation and her conceptualization of the system of white supremacy racism. Regularly have our installment on the compensatory call-in for Albino Affairs and have talked about why this is significant and why white people have such value for different albino species and what have you. Lo and behold, they have a whole talk at the University of Washington, Human Rights in Practice, an Overview of the Journey to Protect People with Albinism in Africa and Globally, talk with Ikponwosa Ero, non-white female with albinism, classified as black with albinism. Absolutely fascinating. You can probably do a search for the title that I just gave and or her name, Ikponwosa Ero, Ikponwosa, written in the description, Ero, E-R-O, and you'll probably see her talk here at the University of Washington and see some of the other work that she's done. I'm just going to read you really quick what it says from the description. The Center for Global Studies is pleased to welcome albinism human rights advocate Ikponwosa Ero to the University of Washington on February 7 for a public lecture titled Human Rights in Practice, an Overview of the Journey to Protect People with Albinism in Africa and Globally. The talk will take place in Husky Union Building, blah, blah, blah. Ms. Ero is a lawyer by training and the first United Nations independent expert on the enjoyment of human rights by persons with albinism. Born in Nigeria with albinism, Ms. Ero was inspired to become a lifelong advocate for the protection and governmental recognition of all peoples born with albinism. Her experiences and impacts span across multiple continents over more than a decade of policy research and advocacy, having worked with several government agencies and organizations to further the rights of persons with albinism and being a leader in more than 20 international human rights resolutions at both the United Nations and the African Union. She has also authored several articles that examine the legal frameworks in the field of albinism as well as categorization of those with albinism in the context of international human rights. And I'll stop there. It gives a bit more detail, but I was intrigued as soon as I saw it, and wow, it lived up to all of my eagerness. Now, just for the beginnings, mostly white people were at this event. Duh, it was at the University of Washington. It looked like mostly students. I'd say probably undergrad students, if I had to guess, even though there were some grad school students, law school students, that sort of thing, too. If I had to estimate, I'd say probably in the neighborhood of 150 people, probably 85% white, 80 to 85% white. Very few. I may have been the only. I'll say two. I think there may have been two to three black males total. Anyway, they had sign language and they had closed captioning. They had a big screen and it was live time. So just as you're speaking, the captioning would pop up on the screen so you could keep up. Now, that is amazing. Accessibility for all, right on. However, they did not have any of that for Dorothy Roberts or any of the other talks that I've been to. None of that. Now, I will add that Ikponwosa Ero, she did say that she is legally blind. So, I don't know. It may have been because of that, but I don't know why. They weren't doing the sign language for her. It was for the audience. I don't know. Maybe. Maybe it was a request that she made, but I was taken aback by that. And they actually had two different white people. They were trading off, and they signed the entire time during the talk, question period, all of that. Didn't have that at any of the other talks that I've been present for. They also had food. Now, they had refreshments at the talk with the panel discussion that Dorothy Roberts was featured at. Now, they had pretty fancy hors d'oeuvres. They had Derby cheese. I don't know if you all have had that before, but it's green cheese. I was totally amazed by that. But here they had pizza, so maybe that's probably equal, because they had really fancy hors d'oeuvres and lots of fruit and cheeses and all that good stuff and different tea for Dorothy Roberts, so that's probably a push. But they had pizza and monk fruit Capri Suns. At first I was taken aback, like Capri Suns, and then I had to go read the ingredients, like, what? Monk fruit? Like, no craziness, no artificial, you know, put the old high fructose net. Nope, none of that. Monk, I don't even know, do they have monk fruit sweetened Capri Suns in your area? You can let me know. Anyway, so they had refreshments and they offered a meet and greet afterwards with food and such. And I was like, dang, that would have been cool with Dorothy Roberts. Like, that, wow. Anyway, So, and to start out, one of the white women who was doing the sign language, they were just chatting in the, 10, 15 minutes before the event began. And the one white woman who was signing, she said, well, they were talking about the most expensive salad that they've had. And she said that she had a $30 salad while she was visiting Canada. It was a CBD $30 salad. And she didn't seem to grouse about it too much. White people are balling hard. Anyway, so they have the event. Miss Ikponwosa Ero, she goes to tell us about albinism. She emphasizes that you do not call individuals people, albinos, call them people with albinism, to emphasize that they are people, much the way we do with non-white people, that sort of thing, emphasizing that white supremacy racism dehumanizes non-white people. They also talked about, or she talked about how people with albinism are disabled, and she went into the details of why that is. And she, as I already said, the vision problems, and she said that she is legally blind, and that many people with albinism struggle with vision problems, and that the sun, of course, in fact, she said that is the number one problem, skin cancer. There can be other issues as well, but that is the big one, skin cancer, and having to protect yourself from the sun and all of that. So I understood the disability listing made immediate sense. She said that people with albinism can be classified as victims of racial discrimination. I said, wow. And they went into the definition as to why that is. And they said the way that racial discrimination is defined in the United Nations, it is mistreating someone because of their racial classification or their skin color, meaning actual pigmentation. And she said, since that's, what it is with people with albinism, where they're being attacked because their lack of pigmentation, or, we're going to use your body parts in some sort of magic potion or whatever it is, that would be mistreatment on the basis of skin color, racial discrimination, which I found fascinating. I had never heard that before. She pointed out that there is, she had it on her projections, that it is intriguing. There's an intrigue about the attacks, the violent attacks against people with albinism on the continent of Africa. And she talked about how there is a dramatic aspect because they don't really have attacks with machetes and that sort of thing in other parts of the world, and dismembering people. Like, they just don't have that in other parts of the world, at least to this point. And so she said that, I guess, gives it a more dramatic sense. Now, this is my interpretation, but I think certainly in a system of white supremacy racism, to have melanin deficient people, even though they are not classified as white, but melanin deficient, so they are maybe what the term they white presenting, and to have them being attacked by melanin dominant humans, oh man, I can see how that would be highly dramatized worldwide in a system of white supremacy racism. She said they got documentaries on Netflix, so maybe it is. But she said that people with albinism in other parts of the world are attacked, mistreated, but it's not with that same level of violence and such that can be dramatized, which I found interesting as well. Now, she said that she was accused of having white privilege, in quotes. And I said, wow, you'll hear it in the audio. Now, I was able to ask a number of questions, which you will hear in the audio, and she covered a lot of subject matter. However, there was a pause. I told you they had pizza, and plenty of it, and monk fruit sweetened Capri Suns. So there was a pause, and they said, we'll do the meet and greet. So they paused. I stopped recording because people were going to get pizza, and including Miss Arrow. She was going to get monk fruit sweetened Capri Suns and all the rest of it. And so I'm not recording because it was nothing to record. People eating and, you know, being rowdy. So Miss Arrow comes back and she basically is sitting next to me. And so I get to immediately ask, who said that you had white privilege? And she said it was a black person who said that you're able to get all of this attention on your issues at the United Nations because, I'll use the phrasing again, the white jargon, you are white presenting. I said, wow. Miss Arrow said, I will not push back against that. There may be some truth to that as to why we're able to get a certain amount of attention for our issues. I said, wow. Wow. Now, that's not in the recording, like I said, because it happened so fast that, you know, I'd stop. I just didn't think to turn the recording back on at that point. And they kept using the term informal, so that was enough to have me relaxed as well. So I didn't record that part, but oh man, we covered so much in the informal part that was not discussed during the formal discussion. So I'm going to try to make sure that I include some of the really important tidbits from the informal discussion that we had afterwards, because I was able to ask even more questions during this period. Now, she touched on albinism in other parts of the world and those individuals being mistreated as well, like Japan, them having to dye their hair and such. I don't know. I'd be curious to know if people that are classified as white who suffer from albinism, if they are also mistreated, like Anderson Cooper, does he have a story of being maligned and mistreated going through school? Like, I'd be curious to know about that. Anyway, during the informal session, she said that because she had discussed how if you are born with albinism, the parents, especially if they're highly melanated black people born on the continent of Africa, the parents, it can cause a lot of conflict between them. Like, you know, were you cheating on me? Is this a defect from your side of the family or my side of the family? Blah, blah, blah. It's your fault. That, you know, it can cause a lot of stress for the parents in dealing with all of this. And sometimes they are not supportive of their child with albinism. And so during the informal part that wasn't recorded, I asked, how was the support from your family? And she said, very honestly, she said that they were not the worst. She said that they did support her. She said, initially, I think there was some conflict about who is to blame for this. And then she said some of her patrilineal relatives, father's side, that they also had offspring. I think she said about three of them who also had albinism. And so that kind of cinched it that this was something from the father's side. And so, yeah, she said that for the most part, they were supportive, but, you know, a few things here or there where they were, I guess, could have been better. And then, she's born in Nigeria, Miss Arrow. She's born in Nigeria. She said she moved to Canada at 15. She said when she moved to Canada, she was called a white nigger by an Indian person, so-called. And she said that this taught her quite a bit about the dynamics of racism. Now, I found that, you know, fascinating on so many parts. Now, one, I wish she had said that during the formal part, and or I wish I had been recording during the afterwards session. But, man, like, I mean, I can't even imagine. So I'm albino, legally blind, and I'm a white nigger. I'm legally blind, man. Like, what? Anyway, I asked her during the informal session, I said, so can you pass as a white person? And she immediately, no hesitation, said, absolutely not. She said, you know, people look at me, and like I said, you can look online and you can see what she looks like. She has lots of photos and such. You can see for yourself. But she said, you know, when I go out, people see me, you know, I could not trick people. Now, she said she was walking in New York, and she said it was a black person looked at her and said, I see you. I see you. I see what you're doing over there trying to fit in. I see you. Now, she's, you know, but that's what I look like. I got albino. What do you mean? That's what I look like. That's what I look like. I'm not trying to do anything. What do you mean? I'm legally blind. Like, what do you mean? I'm disabled. Like, man. But she said no. She said she could not pass as a white person, and that she thinks she would be recognized as a non-white person. You can, you know, evaluate for yourself. I found it fascinating. You will hear that she talks about how there was resistance to albinism being included in the issues in the UN from the disability community, that they did not want to add albinism as a part of disability and focus on that. Like, oh, no, that's something else. Get out of here. And she said that they just listed it under the list of problems for Africa. To associate attacks on albinism with Africa. And I said, well, why? Oh, I think you'll hear that. You'll hear that. Anyway, but I said, you know, the disability, can you give us some more details? And so during the talk that you will hear, she said that it was from the global north where they got resistance. Now, I think I did ask during the session you'll hear, when you say global north, is that mostly individuals classified as white? And even then, I had to ask a couple of questions to finally get down that, yes, this was mostly white people who were resistant. Now, that I also found fascinating, where some people think that you might be getting attention on these issues of albinism, especially if it's black people hacking up and chopping up pale folks. But they do not want to shift if it's going to mean funding or talking about this as a disability. Like, whoa, whoa, whoa. We are disabled, talking about white people and whatever that means for them, not you. And I mean, she said, I'm legally blind. How is this not a disability issue? Get out of here. That's one of them. That's some of that Afro witchcraft. Yes, we'll talk about that. I will. I'm glad I'm getting some snickering in here, because I did snicker many times inappropriately at this, just because I was thinking about it in context of racism. And I mean, I laugh at a lot of things that are not funny, but when she said she was called a white nigger, that was one. When she detailed how in Japan they have to dye their hair and all that, that was another. Like, I could think of a number. Like, if I went back and listened to it with you, I could pick. Well, you might even be able to hear many times where I was snickering throughout inappropriately, but I was in the front row. So yeah. Anyway, let's see. What else did we miss from the informal part? She cannot pass. She got support. She did not have an accurate definition of racism that was not recorded. I didn't get to hear the entire definition, but it didn't seem accurate. We even got to ask during the informal portion, what do you mean when you say global north and global south? She gave a big smile and she said, I've been thinking about that and trying to think of better terms. And I blurted out, white. Non-white. She smiled again, like, sometimes that's just what it is. It's not a geographic thing. I'm white Elon Musk. I'm white anywhere in the known universe. And what that means is boss. God, I gotta tell you all what to do. Boss you around. I get to make the rules. I decide what's gonna happen. I'm in charge. That's what that means. Anyway, that's, I think, many of the major, but now other people asked questions as well during the informal session. Some of the students asked questions and other tidbits, but the racial components, we were able to address a number of different questions there, which I would, the white nigger, again, I wish that had been included, but wow, what we got was fascinating, and I think reveals quite a bit about the system of white supremacy racism. In fact, Miss Ero even said that she thinks she has, or that people with albinism have a unique vantage point about racism because of their perspective. that they can contribute to kind of help, you know, solve this problem, which I have heard from other individuals, particularly those who have one white parent and one non-white parent. I've heard them use similar jargon. It doesn't, all of that does not end up with these individuals having accurate understand or accurate definitions. That's what I meant to say. It does not end up with them having what I view as accurate definitions of white supremacy, racism, or even using accurate concepts. We get global north and global south, which is very popular. Anywho, I will leave it there. It did stand out to me as well, and immediately so. As soon as I saw the flyer promoting this event, the fact that this was happening during Black History Month, oh, that stood out to me immediately. Like, out of all the different events and talks and, you know, things that we could have talked about for this month and speakers and subject matters and things of import, albinism on the continent, in the world. Not that, I mean, hey, I do not want to suffer from skin cancer. I don't want to be legally blind. None of that. But why? There is one more tidbit. She gives a report and a scholar. She gives the name. I asked her to spell it out. You'll hear that in the recording. There's a scholar who did a study of why so-called African witch doctors and such, why do they place a value on the body parts of people with albinism that leads to them being attacked, dismembered, sometimes their bodies exhumed after they've been buried, like just really grisly, disgraceful misbehavior and mistreatment. When did this start? What is the origins of all of this? And there's a scholar, you'll hear it all named out correctly, who theorizes that this is related to the beginning of so-called capitalism. Now, she's talking specifically about Tanzania, but the beginnings of capitalism that the non-white people there could not grasp because they were about community and sharing everything, not some person is a billionaire. And it happened in 2 weeks. Like, what? They just could not conceptualize that. So things began being valued like body part. And even that is a big part of so-called capitalism, which is who full of say are the master capitalists. Racist man, racist woman. Capitalism is about practicing white supremacy racism. Profit from it, but practicing white supremacy racism, and that these people began to associate value with Negro body parts just like our friends. I might be butchering it, pardon the pun, but I think that's pretty close to the thesis. She just uses the term capitalism, insert white supremacy racism. But you'll hear that in the recording. I did ask during the informal session, do you think that that theory is accurate? She said, yes, I do think there's some merits to that theory. Whew. Wow. Mind blowing. Dr. Welsing did speak with us about albinism way back in the archives. She used to have so much to say on this subject matter. Anyway, without further ado, we will get to it. It was absolutely fascinating. The scholar, again, Ikponwosa, Ikponwosa Ero, E-R-O, Human Rights in Practice, a journey, an overview of the journey to protect people with albinism in Africa and globally. Talk with Ikponwosa Ero. Woo! Albino Affairs for Negro History Month. Context of White Supremacy.
It's wonderful to see so many people here. So before I begin with introductions, I'd like to begin with our land acknowledgement. The Jackson School acknowledges that we are in Coast Salish territory, the traditional homelands of the Duwamish, Suquamish, Muckleshoot, and other indigenous peoples. The Jackson School understands that the international community includes sovereign American Indian tribes, First Nations, and indigenous people across the world. So again, thank you all for being here, and it's wonderful to see so many students here. For students, if you're unaware, the first generation leaders in law and the Jackson School Students Association are going to be sponsoring a pizza meet and greet with our speaker today afterwards. So there's free pizza, and you'll actually get to talk to somebody who is an international human rights advocate. So stick around for that if you have a chance. I'd also like to thank the Center for Human Rights, the Africa Studies Program, the Jackson School of International Studies, along with the Center for Global Studies for putting on today's event. And I want to give a special shout out to Phil Shackleton, who in a very busy week for the Center for Global Studies, helped organize this event for today. So I would like to introduce Andrea Woody, who will be introducing our speaker for today. Andrea Woody is the Divisional Dean of Social Sciences and Professor of Philosophy at the University of Washington. She is adjunct faculty in the departments of Dance, History, and Gender, Women, and Sexuality Studies. Professor Woody is Editor-in-Chief of Philosophy of Science and a member of the Editorial Board of Foundations of Chemistry. She served as Chair of the Department of Philosophy from 2016 to 2022. She probably has the most well-rounded educations you could imagine, with degrees in chemistry, theater and dance, and a doctorate in philosophy of science, from Princeton and the University of Pittsburgh. So, Andrea?
Thank you so much, everybody. I am really honored to be able to do the introductions today, both because I am so happy that our speaker is joining us, and also to celebrate this sort of work. As Divisional Dean of Social Sciences, I think we both the work in the college aims to be directed towards learning and activity that supports social justice, human rights, making the world a better place. We draw students who don't want a disengaged education, but want to think about how the work that they do here at the university can bleed out beyond our campus and allow them to have lives with real impact. And so places like the Jackson School, the Center for Human Rights, the Center for Global Studies are really central to those activities, and they provide a real model for interdisciplinary collaboration. And so I'm glad you're all here, and I'm really glad to be part of it. So I'm honored to be able to introduce the speaker for our gathering today for a talk titled Human Rights in Practice, an Overview of the Journey to Protect People with Albinism in Africa and Globally. Now, this topic overlaps with central aims of the university to cultivate understanding of cultures around the globe and to appreciate the diversity of human cultural and social structures, to contribute through our research and teaching to a deep, nuanced understanding of human rights in ways that can support public policy, political and legal action, and support the multiplicity of human rights concerns that touch upon social justice issues related to racial, ethnic, gender, age, and neurodiversity. So, Ikponwosa Ero has served as the first United Nations independent expert on the enjoyment of human rights by persons with albinism. She's a lawyer by training and has over a decade of experience in the research, policy, and practice of international human rights. In this context, she's worked with and advised multiple organizations and governments around the world and was a key contributor to over 20 resolutions at the AU and UN on human rights of people with albinism, as well as on the elimination of harmful practices. Ikponwosa Ero is a principal architect of several historic international initiatives on marginalized groups including the African Union Plan of Action on Albinism in Africa and the Pan-African Parliament's guidelines on the elimination of harmful practices related to accusation of witchcraft and ritual attacks. She's currently the director of human rights advocacy at Under the Same Sun, the executive director of the African Albinism Network, and a leadership coach for several senior executives in public service sectors. Her many awards include being recognized in 2015 by UNESCO as among the top 70 women speakers worldwide, which I think bodes very well for the experience we're about to have, and receiving the International Advocate Award by the United States Council on Disabilities in 2020. We are so happy to have you here.
Hello, everyone. Wow. Wow, it's so loud in here. Hello, everyone.
Hi.
Nice to meet all of you, and thank you very much, Dean, for that wonderful introduction. It's a privilege to be here at UW. It's my first time at this university, even though it's not my first time in Seattle. So I really appreciate the welcome I've received from Stephen, the support I received from Phil, and from all of you. It's a lot of people who made this happen, so thank you very much. I have been told that I have 50 minutes. I'm going to try to make this engaging as much as possible, and I would like questions at the end because I found that that uses time better. I will try to stick to my time because someone advised me once that there is no such thing as a bad short speech. So I will try to keep it short. Okay, so let's go. As you know, this is the title. We're going to be talking about human rights in practice and the case study of people with albinism in Africa and globally. So that's me, and of course, my natural hair color. So I was serving as the United Nations' first independent expert on albinism from 2015 to 2021. So 6 years. So what happens is the Human Rights Council has several areas they would like to work at, but they can't do everything, okay? So the UN has the main office in New York and then another in Geneva. And the main difference is the one in New York focuses on economic issues, preventing wars, like what you call like the hard stuff. I don't like that divide, but it does help people conceptualize the difference. In Geneva, we focus on what people call the philosophical themes, human rights, you know, the ideal world. And that's I was based out of Geneva. Now, in Geneva, there's a lot of issues. There are women rights issues, disabilities, and all that. They can't do everything. So what they do is they assign experts to be their hands and feet, and we're mostly called independent expert because you don't get paid to do that job. I just make that clear. But what that does for you is it protects you from being negatively influenced by countries. It still happens. Like Saudi Arabia can decide to sponsor your report, for instance. But generally, we're independent. So I was appointed in 2015 to deal with what the Red Cross called a small-scale genocide. So I put that in quotes because that's how they saw the attacks against people with albinism. So at that point, people with albinism were being attacked at a rate of about 3 per month. And this sounds very low, but when you think about the fact that usually there's 1 in about 10,000 people with albinism, then 3 per month is really high. Because in a country like, say, Tanzania, which was reporting the highest cases at that time, everyone knows where you live because you look different, you stand out. Like, my whole family is visibly black. Like, what you mean, what you would see from someone from West Africa. So, and you look like that, everyone knows where you live. When I was growing up in Nigeria, everyone knew, oh, the girl, the albino girl lives over there. Everyone knows. So when one person is attacked and there are only 3 in that community, you're talking 30% of the population. So this proportionality was very mind-boggling, and that's why they called it a small-scale genocide. And they asked me to try to do something about the attacks, to work with countries, and secondly, to just promote their human rights in general. So my presentation is going to focus on this outline. So the first thing we'll do is to introduce what human rights are to those who are not familiar. It's a very basic introduction. Then we'll go to the case of people with albinism. What were the human rights issues that were flagged when this mandate was created? we'll go into some of the barriers to resolving those issues. You know, when you're in university, you study human rights and you study law and you feel like, okay, just take this and apply it to this and your solution is that. The equation is very simple. When you go into life, there's numerous factors that make it very complex. And one of the things you can do for yourselves as students is to learn how to navigate complexity, because life is complex. Here you learn how to play violin, you learn how to play piano, you get out pretty good at it. And then you get out to life and what you have is an orchestra and you have to conduct it and produce good music. So anything that can help you manage complexity, to listen to other people and try to balance everything at stake, that will be a very good tool for you to navigate anywhere you find yourself. Because what happened was, even though there were human rights protected for people with albinism, we were protected, the reality was very different, and I'll explain what that meant. I'll also explain how we overcame those barriers so you can see how we overcame some of the complexities that came up along the way. I'll talk about some of the key outcomes, because we did make inroads, and I would say it was a overall successful use of human rights, and talk about some of the implications, and then we can conclude for questions and answers. Okay, so what are human rights? These are basically universal standards that we as human beings decided to put in place to protect us from one another. We can, as you all know, we can be very good people, but we can also be the opposite of that. And after two great wars in which we decided to kill each other in the millions, it was necessary that we recognize that each of us, because we're human, there's something about being human that separates us from other creatures, like especially our capacity to reason, to separate one thing from the other using arguments. So what the world decided, most of the world, because when the Human Rights Declaration was made in 1948, lots of countries were under colonial authority. But nonetheless, the world at that time decided that there will be this Declaration of Human Rights, which celebrated 75 years last year. So I would say as humanity, we've done very well, 75 years of having these ideals. And the principles behind the Declaration of Human Rights is that each of us here, by being human, have a dignity that no other creature has, and that nobody has a right to take that away. So that's what rights mean. It's your inherent dignity, needs protection. And the freedoms, nobody can come to you and say, take away your freedom to have a belief or your freedom not to have a belief. Human rights also helps us balance issues. If somebody believes in witchcraft and they believe my body parts can be good for witchcraft practices, and that's their right to religion, how do you balance that right with my right to bodily integrity? So human rights is a very good framework for balancing dignities and the questions that come out of our rights and our freedoms. The only thing about the UDHR is that it's not binding. There's no international police force. So the best we've done is have the international mechanisms like the Human Rights Council, the UN General Assembly can come in and shame people, naming and shaming, they call it in the UN, through resolutions and through press statements and through boycotts, like sanctions. So those are the best they can do, really. The beauty of the UDHR is that it has given birth to many other treaties based on human rights. For instance, you all might be familiar with, there's a treaty on civil and political rights called the ICCPR. There's a treaty on economic, social, and cultural rights called the ICESR, or whatever how they pronounce that. Now, this may sound boring to you, but it's very interesting what happened. After the UDHR was formed, people realized this is a philosophical document. How can we bring it to reality? So they decided to make two covenants and separate the rights into two. In their head, they put the civil and political rights in one covenant and the economic, social, cultural rights in another. The reasoning behind it was the right to vote, the right to form your own country, the right to run for political office, the civil and political rights took priority over the economic, social, and cultural rights, which included right to health, right to housing, right to work. Why? Because they felt like if you don't have a state, if you're not protected in a country, you won't have the other rights. But over time, there has been a huge debate about this perspective, saying that this division is artificial, and at the end of the day, they are all interlinked. if you give people the right to health, you give them good work, they will agitate less in the state. There will be less protest and there will be peace and the state can form. So there's more of this principle of interdependence of human rights that has been pushed nowadays. But I would say some countries, when they want to evade issues like the attacks on people with albinism, their argument is, please let's focus on civil and political rights. When that's in place, your people will be protected, right? But it's an artificial distinction, but just to point that that's still there. There's other treaties, like the treaties on the rights of a child, the treaty on women, treaties on people with disabilities that have all emerged from this. So if you Google International Bill of Rights, you'll find all the rights all coming from the UDHR. So it's a pretty important document. But when people with albinism started being attacked, the first time it came out in 2008, it was pretty shocking. At that point, I was working for the Department of Justice and it was very distressing. Because what was happening was there was a belief by people who practice so-called witchcraft that the people with albinism can be attacked and their body parts can be hacked off, preferably alive. I'm sorry that this is gruesome, but it is what some people were facing. And that when those body parts are used in witchcraft, you can become rich, you can get a good job, you can get a promotion, you can fall in love and all that jazz. When this was happening in 2008, there was very little awareness about people with albinism at all, that it even happened in Africa. It was more something you saw in Hollywood movies. And so many people didn't understand the issue. So how do you go from that to even getting protection? We're talking a very small group of people, probably tens of thousands in one country, right? The other issue we faced in getting the human rights applied was no resource. One thing at the UN is like a marketplace. If you've ever been there, I don't know if anyone has been to the UN in this room. Has anyone been to the UN in this room? Oh, wow, Stephen, you need to take them. Okay, but one thing, it's like a marketplace and everyone is pushing their ideas. Everyone, like everything you can think of. So how do you push through that? Usually it's resource. You can tell the world resource people are hosting events like this at the UN, which costs thousands of dollars. Because you have to do interpretation, you have to bring food. So resource is a huge deal. So you can have the UDHR, but it means nothing if you don't have any resource. People want the best for you, but if there's no resource, they can't do a lot for you. We're also a minority group. I know this is really small, and I apologize for that. We're also a minority group in terms of numbers. Like I said, 10,000 people in one country is quite small. In Canada, it's supposed to be like 1 in 17,000. In parts of Africa, it's much higher. So the UN focuses on big things. They think, okay, we want to deal with like end malaria, so 10 million people are protected, end HIV/AIDS, so millions of people are protected. But in this group, they're thinking, how are we going to deal with this? It's too small, right? But then the people are dying, they're being attacked. So how do you convince people whose mindset is about aggregation to focus on a small group of people? There was also the issue of disability. Like, people with albinism are a subset of people with disability. So a lot of pushback we received was, go talk to the people with disability. But when we got to the people with disability, they are thinking, look, we represent 1 billion people, and we have a lot of problems. Wait in line, okay? So, but we didn't have that luxury to wait in line. The longer we waited, the more the attacks were coming in. So that was another barrier we faced, was this, the power struggle within the movement. The African Union, who should have taken the lead role, couldn't take the lead role. They have their own systemic issues, you see. Most people don't pay their dues. They have their charter that they have to follow. They don't follow it because they have problems in their countries. So people don't really pay attention there unless they're pushed. And then there's this principle of progressive realization of rights, which I had alluded to before, that people find that some rights should take precedence over others. And so as a result, they feel, you guys can wait in line. Let's stop the attacks, but after that, just wait in line. But we were arguing that if we don't do more, the attacks will come back. Okay, and then the final barrier we faced were people saying that, look, let's focus on developing these countries, because when you do, these issues you're speaking of will go away. But we were saying, no, it's the other way around. Protect the people, and then they will help you to develop the country. So this argument, what comes first, human rights or development? Some people say it's an artificial debate. Others say there's a hierarchy. I don't know what you think. So we succeeded. We did succeed. Here is a trend in cases of attacks. Between 2008 and 2004, you can see that if I have done like the curve instead, you would have seen a downward trend. The blue is killings, red survivors, green trafficking, purple those who claimed asylum as refugees. There's been at least 20 cases in the United States. Like, I've testified in Florida, New York, Chicago. I don't think there's been a case in Seattle yet, but it's close to 20 cases. Blue, aqua is missing people, and orange on top is graves that were exhumed, because some people decided, okay, I'm not gonna kill them, I'll just go to the graves and dig up the bodies. I should make it clear that some people don't believe in the witchcraft, they just wanna participate because there's money. The body parts of people with albinism allegedly sell for thousands of US dollars, according to the Red Cross from the investigation. A limb was priced at 2,000 and a full corpse was 75,000. This was 2008. So with that kind of promise, people would put aside morality in some cases. But what I wanted to point out to you with this graph is just the trend that it's going down, there's hope. But so this is when 2008, when the case first came out in the international media, look how high it was. And then it started going down with awareness. Then it spiked again around here. I'm not sure why, maybe the awareness kind of waned a little bit. And then it went down here, I think because they were trying to create International Albinism Awareness Day in 2014. So there was a lot of UN awareness. When the mandate was created, you will see there was a spike for the first 3 years. My theory is that I was receiving more reports because there was a visible person there to pay attention. For instance, I went to Malawi with 66 cases in hand. I left with 115. Because when people saw me, they were like, oh my God, I need to tell you, this happened to my brother. Or a police officer came to me and said, look, I have 25 cases I just never shared with my superiors. So the cases jumped because of the mandate, I think. And then with a lot of work in the mandate, it started to decline. And then you can see around the pandemic, there was a spike, because whenever there's a socioeconomic crisis, witchcraft beliefs and practices go up. So let's hope that the trend keeps going down. Okay. So my main argument, really, if I have a thesis here, is that generally I believe human rights are a powerful tool to protect people from human rights violations. Because the primary duty bearer is the state or the country. But human rights allows for non-state actors to participate. For instance, we collaborated with a cosmetic company in New York, a dermatology company that does plastic surgeries and all that, and they donated a billboard in Times Square, and we made a big deal out of that. So very unusual partner for human rights, but human rights does allow for that. Specifically though, my thesis is that human rights is designed for large groups. And people don't think about that, especially if they come from smaller ones. Like, not just us, but the caste system in India. When I was at the UN, there's this group called the Dalits, D-A-L-I-T-S. They're the lowest caste, one of the lowest castes, I believe, in India. And I saw them at the UN struggle quite a bit, because the UN is not designed for us. It's designed for bigger groups and bigger issues, which is unfortunate, because you would think we should be the ones to get the protection because we're few, right? However, despite that problem, I believe that we can do it. If you're a minority group and you want to use the human rights system, it's possible. You just have to fight differently. I don't know if you've read the book by Malcolm Gladwell called David and Goliath, where his main thesis was, if you are David, which means you're the underdog, the only way to fight and win the giant Goliath is to use unexpected weapons, yeah? So in the David and Goliath story, which comes out of the Hebrew Jewish Bible, the giant Goliath, I don't know if everybody knows the story, but I will not presume. The giant challenges David, 13 or 15 year old boy, to fight. And Goliath is a giant with a huge shield and a spear and whatever, everything. Like, he was completely loaded. And David had a slingshot. And he won the battle only because Goliath was coming with a presumption that the battle could only be fought one way. So if you want to fight the giants in your life, try to find other ways that the giant doesn't expect. Try to find other weapons to fight that are not expected. And that's what we did. Okay, I'll just take a commercial break to talk about albinism. What is albinism? So it's a genetic condition that happens in every race, in all countries of the world. It results in a lack of pigmentation, and lack of pigmentation causes vulnerability to light, vulnerability to the sun. So you can imagine climate change is another issue happening in hot countries where people with albinism are especially vulnerable. It also results in a visual impairment. Most people with albinism are considered legally blind, so am I, which means you have 20 over 200 vision and worse, as opposed to 20/20. That means what people see clearly from 200 feet away, you can see clearly from 20 feet away. So that's legal blindness. The frequency of the condition varies according to the country. In Africa, it estimates are 1 in 1,000 to 1 in 15,000, whereas in North America, including here, 1 in 4,500 to 1 in 17,000. And lastly, people say people with albinism to emphasize the person over just albino, which conflates the person and the condition. So, just a small photo to show you people with albinism worldwide, the variations in appearance, and I always point out this interesting pair, I don't know if you can see it, they're twins. One has albinism, one doesn't. They're from Kenya. And from different countries, you can see how it manifests. Okay, so how it happens is both parents have to carry the gene. If both parents carry the gene at each pregnancy, there is a 25% chance that a child will have albinism. Sorry, moving fast because of time. There are also different types of albinism. There's the one that affects only the eyes called ocular albinism. So I have a cousin who's like black, more visibly black, and his eyes are very green, ocular albinism. There's also the one affecting the skin, hair, and eyes, which is the type I have. It's called ocular and cutaneous. So ocular, cutaneous, eyes and skin albinism. That's what everyone in this photo has, ocular, cutaneous. And by the way, the gentleman squatting is from Seattle. That's a nice coincidence. He's a businessman with albinism here in Seattle. I should have told him about this. So he was there in Tanzania. So it's part of the weapons as David that we pulled out was to find well-to-do people with albinism. There are not very many of them. But the ones we found were able to really help the cause. Some pictures showing albinism, how it manifests. So the first two men are brothers, same father and mother. They're from Canada. This gentleman here started under the same sun, one of the organizations I work for, and that's his brother without albinism. The girl in the middle is from Tanzania, and the guy in the far right also from Tanzania with ocular or eye-only albinism. So let's quickly go over what the human rights issues were, given the context. Of course, you can guess, the first one, right to life. Nobody should be attacked because of how they look, let alone based on the belief that their body parts can be used in witchcraft. Many of the killing cases were attacks that were done by machetes, so it was very brutal. Oftentimes they wanted a body part, but the victim would die from bleeding. There was security of person, it's the second right that's quite essential. Torture, as you can imagine, the way the attacks happen. Grave desecration, which is a crime in many countries. Health, the right to health. Skin cancer is actually the number one killer of people with albinism worldwide, not just in Africa, but in South Asia, South America, all the hot countries, because many countries don't put sunscreen on their list of essential medicines, the same way as they put antibiotics or anti-malaria meds or HRVs, ARVs for people with HIV. They don't put sunscreen on their medicines list, so people have no access. And by age 40, nearly 80% would have already had skin cancer, and a huge proportion of that die by age 40 from skin cancer. There is also the issue of disability because of vision. I mentioned that. And of course, this affects the right to education, the right to employment, which is also impacted by the appearance. Like in India, we got reports of people not getting jobs because, oh, the customer sees you, they'll run away because they think you're a ghost or you're going to contaminate the food. There's also harmful practices, which you can imagine, the witchcraft practices fall under. It's okay to believe in witchcraft. It's okay. And this is where human rights is really powerful. It lets people believe what they want. Where human rights draws the line is when it becomes an action that impacts somebody. So harmful practices is a technical term defined at the UN as any practice that harms people and it's done systematically and constantly. So like female genital cutting, early child marriage, those are all harmful practices. And one of our successes was to put accusation of witchcraft and ritual attacks under this. We succeeded to get UN to put this issue under the catalogs of harmful practices. We also, of course, have the issue of refugees, as I mentioned earlier, that the US has several. The issue of minority rights, racial discrimination. This is interesting because racial discrimination is not only, according to the UN, discrimination based on race. It's also based on color, and that color can be separate from race. That's why it's called racial, not race discrimination. That's why within some cultures you have colorism, right? People who face colorism can claim racial discrimination because it's discrimination based on color, even within the same race. And lastly, the issue was our local authorities have failed us. Okay, let me fly through this since I have like, what, 15 minutes? Okay, so the life of a person with albinism, the difficulty we're now facing that we're trying to advocate for at the UN, advocate about, is that when they were born, they faced infanticide. If they survived infanticide, they may or may not get an education because of the low vision or because of bullying. If they didn't get an education, they may or may not get employment, especially employment indoors. Many people didn't get employment indoors. They're working outdoors in the sun, and this causes skin cancer in addition to poverty and oftentimes early death. Just some data on the attacks in total. There's been over 1,000 cases recorded in the last decade or so in 30 countries. The most recent was 2 weeks ago when a woman who died from skin cancer in Malawi on January 24, they tried to excavate her body and take it. They didn't succeed, so the next morning her family and police went to secure her gravesite with cement. Civil society, including me, we believe there are more cases that are not reported because family members are often involved and prosecution is slow and poor. So we're nearing the end, hang in there. So how did we overcome the barriers? First of all, this is where our strategies started to come in. Our minority status, because we were a small group, people at the UN didn't think our issue would have clout. If you try to get a celebrity to speak for you, they would be like, they want something that could give them social credit. Like, oh, we're going to cure malaria in 50 countries, so we're going to save 500 million lives. Like, they want something that is very flashy, but we were just there going, we just want to save these people who are extra vulnerable. So what we did was, after strategizing, we actually had involved business people. I know there's always a thinking that corporations are evil, but just as there are evil people in general, there are also good people in corporations. So we brought in corporate experts, we brainstormed with them, since human rights was not opening for us. And what we did eventually from these sessions was we went to approach underdogs, ambassadors that were underdogs. So for instance, our main ambassador was the ambassador from Somalia. So Somalia is a small country in the east of Africa, and they don't have a lot of power at the UN. But this man was exceptional, and he took on our cause. He fought for the cause, because at the UN, as a non-country person, you cannot enter every session. You have to have a country sponsoring your issue. And so we got the ambassador of Somalia to sponsor our issue. So I'm just giving one example of each of how we overcame each barrier, right? There's a lot of examples. And then in terms of lack of awareness, we brought in data. And we just didn't do reports. We came up with really flashy ways to sell the ideas in 5 minutes. Those days, for instance, we would spend months in Geneva chasing ambassadors, including myself. Oh, hi, can I tell you about this issue? And they will tell you, I have no time, or I have only 5 minutes. You literally have to sell your idea in 5 minutes. And this is usually the missing pieces when we do reports or policies, is how to then translate that from paper into action. Okay. Then in terms of the disability movement, because we got pushback from the movement, we had to try to make ourselves look bigger. So we started working within the racial discrimination space, focusing on the intersectional identity we have between disability and color, and also bringing in other issues that matter to us, like the issues of women. So we started walking an intersectional walk instead of just strictly being people with disabilities. Resources, like I said, we went after private individuals, but we also had partnerships with unlikely entities, beauty queens, cosmetic industry. In terms of the preference for big issues, it was hard to fight this one, I won't lie. However, we had some luck. So one of the things in life is you get some luck. Like, that's why when you play Monopoly, at some point it says, go collect $200. I think it's a good representation of what happens in life, that even when things are hard, sometimes you get some luck. And what had happened at the UN that gave us some luck was the UN came up with its Sustainable Development Goals agenda. In that agenda, they pledged to leave no one behind. They pledged to focus on minorities. Because what happened was, before the SDGs, they had the MDGs, Millennium Development Goals, and the studies and the reviews of the MDGs showed that it helped groups, but not marginalized groups. So now with the SDGs, they're aiming to leave no one behind. So we wrote on that. On the Global North-South Challenge of people saying, okay, that's an issue for the Global South, get the African Union to deal with it. What we did was we found data from other countries. We showed how people with albinism were treated in India, in China, in Japan, and it was very shocking to the member states. So that's the power of data. But like I said, we brought it in a size and in a manner that was attractive. We didn't do like a 700-page report and brought that to them because they'll never read it. So it was very strategic how we sold them the idea. And lastly, the issue about, okay, should we focus on development versus human rights? What we did was we came up with a parallel track approach where we said, let's deal with the people with albinism, their human rights, and then in terms of the development, we do that at the same time. They're not mutually exclusive. Like, human nature always likes going to the extremes, like the polar ends of things. But usually there's shades of gray between those black and white poles. And I haven't seen the Shades of Gray show, so I'm just saying that I haven't seen it, honestly. But it's true that really success usually is in that shades of gray. And so we showed them how we could do both human rights and development and stop having this dichotomous or binary thinking all the time. It doesn't always, it's not very helpful. So what were some of the key outcomes? Just this slide. We went in Tanzania, which was the epicenter of attacks, from 3 cases per month at its worst to 1 per year right now. At the UN, they created the mandate. I finished it. Somebody else is serving in the position. There's been over 10 resolutions at the UN on albinism alone. We even had a historic resolution on International Albinism Awareness Day on June 13 now. And we came up with a resolution on harmful practices that are accusations of witchcraft and ritual attacks. So our issue was mostly the ritual attacks, but we joined forces with the people fighting witchcraft in general, because together we had a formidable force, and the UN had a first time ever resolution on the issue in 2021. At the AU level, the disability protocol or the disability convention at the AU level mentions people with albinism. We're the only disability group mentioned in that protocol. They also adopted a plan of action on albinism that we're serving right now. It ends in 2031. Asylum, over 20 cases, known cases in the US alone. And hundreds of people have been relocated to safety. Some of them have prostheses. There's been some generous doctors in America that have donated their time and given functioning prostheses to many people with albinism. Okay, so what are some of the warnings or caveats? Just 3 that I'm highlighting before we conclude. The first one is the Battle of David against Goliath is commendable, but it's a lot of work. Malcolm Gladwell acknowledges that in his book, like showing how a lot of people have succeeded against all odds. However, nobody will say they want to do it again. It's a lot of work. I personally am exhausted from doing it. However, you all are very young, so this is to encourage you that if you find yourself fighting a giant and you're young, by all means do it. Go for it. Fight with weapons that the giant doesn't expect, as long as the weapons are legal and licit and good, right? Do it, because usually there's no other way when you're an underdog in the international human rights system. The second thing is resources. I don't know how people would do it, but just keep that in mind. If you want to fight the underdog's battle in the international human rights system, you will need resources. It doesn't have to be cash. I was just saying to colleagues today that you have a center here for human rights, international studies. A lot of universities have that, use the students there to get stuff done in the human rights system without needing cash. And I must acknowledge, as a third caveat, that albinism has a selling factor. People find it an intriguing condition. It's true. It's just like UNICEF, right? UNICEF is the richest UN agency. Why? Because everyone wants children to be protected, right? So it's not like UNDP and other agencies aren't doing well in raising funds. It's just their selling factor is not as strong as UNICEF's. So let's acknowledge that. Interestingly, I did get acknowledged once of having white privilege, which I thought was interesting. But I don't deny that, in the sense that it's possible that people might have felt more connected, so-called white people might have felt more connected to this issue. Maybe they could empathize easily. It's possible, but I always told them that that's all well and good, but if it's that great, would you want to be a person with albinism? usually not. Nobody ever responded to that question. So I think it's very complex, these things, and I would never say that that was not a factor. But yeah, it's just an interesting observation as to all the elements that come to play. Okay, finally, of course, everything is not perfect, despite all the successes we had, of which I've listed very few. There's still stigma. There's still stigma on people with albinism. There's still attitudinal barriers. Disability, I should say, is not only about the physical, what's happening physically. It's also about the attitude towards the person. We always have the challenge of having to re-educate people. If I go back to the UN today, I have to start all over again, looking for people to re-educate. Like, the issue is not sticking as it should, because people tend to stick to ideas that give them social credibility or ideas that personally affect them. And since albinism cannot happen to anybody, it's not gonna affect them personally, mostly. And there's no street credibility in working on disability generally. So it's tough, yeah. So that's a hard selling factor. Resources, as usual, is a problem. The attacks still continue, as I said 2 weeks ago with this potential case, and skin cancer because of climate change. But there is hope, there is hope. Since I started in the movement about 15 years ago, there's now 200 new albinism groups in Africa alone. We now have the Global Albinism Alliance, which I helped to form, and also the Africa Albinism Network, which I helped to lead. So there's hundreds of people behind the scenes that are working on these entities. The issue is already integrated among UN staff and AU staff. Like, people are aware of the issue now. I saw on LinkedIn during the COP, the climate change event in Dubai, UNICEF had put on their LinkedIn a person with albinism, and I thought that was really, it's a sign out of many that they're taking on the issue, there's ownership. And as I said before, attack is on the decline, so that's a positive. And the African Union has decided to appoint an envoy in about 2 weeks from now. We're hoping that person, there's three candidates from three African countries there vying, and this person will be an ambassador to promote the African Union plan of action on albinism. Okay, I think that's it. Yes, it is. And I am on time, I think. So thank you very much.
Okay, I think we've got about 40 minutes for questions. So, do you want to moderate it yourself?
Yes, please.
Okay.
No, you moderate.
Want me to moderate it? Okay, yes.
I have two quick questions. One, did you say you were legally blind?
Yes.
Wow, okay. And two, the portion about people with albinism being associated with, or them being attacked and such, being associated with Africa almost exclusively when there are people with albinism all over the world. Why do you think that is?
I'm not sure. I think there is almost, there's many reasons, and the ones I would highlight is, I think when it comes to Africa, it's easy to point out the problems we have, whereas there's a lot of good things happening, and a lot of the African ambassadors at the UN are pushing back on this. This was actually one of our challenges, because when we try to talk about it, the ambassadors were like, okay, you don't want to, like, it's enough. Like, every country has a problem. Why do you keep highlighting our problem? So I think the emphasis on Africa was just, there's a catalog of problems that get promoted on Africa, and it just adding one more was not an issue. And then the other thing was that I think that this type of attack was only reported in Africa, this type where, in this form. The attacks you saw in other countries were quite different, more like bullying, extreme discrimination, but using a machete to hack someone was very regionally specific.
Ronnie?
I had a quick question about, you had mentioned that there was pushback from the disability movement, and if it's not dredging that back up again, can you talk a little bit about that? Was that primarily from, like, disability activists located in the global north, and how did you kind of push beyond that as a strategy? Because I know that happens in other populations.
That's true. It's very true. So it was a pushback from the disability, mostly in the global north, yes. Because in the disability movement, what we observed was the power was very north-centered. It's centered in the north because they have an alliance called the International Disability Alliance, very centered in the global north. And so their worry, which I understood, was we are breaking the movement. Because they had worked so hard to build a solidarity that led to the Convention on the Rights of People with Disabilities. And here we were, gaining attention with all this. We had big pictures, exhibits, and like I said, it's an intriguing issue. So I think we were getting attention in a way they didn't anticipate, and they felt like you're splitting solidarity. But now I think over the years, what they're learning, and because I've been to several reflection meetings in the last 12 months, what they're realizing is that solidarity was good until the convention. Post-convention, now it's a question, is it needed, that level of control, is it needed? After all, the women's movement had solidarity, got the convention, and now everyone is like on their own. The women's movement does whatever they want. Like, people, as long as there is the convention and people are trying to follow it, there's a marketplace. So I think the disability movement is reckoning with that right now, and I think they will shift into this marketplace approach. But I would say we're pioneers in that, saying that's whatever, we're going to do our thing because people are dying. That's how we responded to them. When we took a lot of flack, I should say, I had a funder tell me that she was actively called and told not to fund the issue.
Dang.
Yeah. So we took a lot of flack for that, but we were motivated by the people because we visited the survivors, people who were like hacked body parts, and only that alone just pushed us forward.
Thank you. In the back?
Yes. So I would say India surprised me because I thought it was ironic how there's a huge light skin industry there. And there are people with albinism where, like, I don't think it's as striking. Like, an African with albinism is definitely more intriguing in terms of the contrast of the features in the skin than someone in India. But the treatment that I got reports on was quite appalling. They were treated like they had leprosy. So the people didn't see them as Indians in light skin. They saw them as disease, right? And so, there were some stories that were very heartbreaking. So I was surprised by that. And then some were dumped in the schools for the blind. Because I should say to your question, the degree of your vision varies by the type of albinism and the type of ethnicity, usually. So people with albinism from India see far less than me, for instance. And they were put in schools for the blind. And even in the school for the blind people were discriminated. The blind people couldn't see them, but were discriminating against them. But they heard that this kind of people were, like, it was a mess. And I just. And wow. So those were really surprising to me. And then in Japan, the people with albinism there, as part of their uniform, were forced to dye their hair. They couldn't look. Yeah, they were forced to, like, as young as 2 years old, were having to dye their hair black. As part of the, you have to be uniform. You can't look like this. So that was a bit surprising. Those are the ones that come to mind. But there's been a lot of stories. There's a report I have online. If you Google it, it's called "People with Albinism: A Human Rights Perspective of Albinism Worldwide," or something like that. Albinism Worldwide: A Human Rights Perspective. Which I wrote with the Center for Human Rights at the University of Toronto. Students like you wrote that with me, and it's very, very telling.
Can you talk about eye color and people who have albinism, most common, least common, myths, et cetera?
The eye color?
Yes, ma'am.
Myths about eye color?
Yes.
So most of the myths are about other things, like people with albinism don't die, they disappear, which we found out later was what people in the past used to cover up for the killings. Like family members would get rid of their own kid and then say, oh, well, it was a time to disappear, because these people disappear. So that's one of the most frightening ones. In terms of the appearance, they also say people with albinism have many people have like skin cancer spots, like just from lack of protection. And they would say like, oh, that's normal with albinism, not knowing you're literally killing the person. There's not so many about the eyes, although there's been, like, I was mocked and bullied that I had cat eyes, or eyes of a feline or whatever, when I was a child. But there wasn't myth around it. There's more bullying around that. Yeah. I don't know if that answered the question.
So what is the most common eye color for people who have albinism?
It varies according to their residual pigmentation. So some people who have, let's say, type 1, which is one of the lightest types you can have, usually have transparent eyes, and then their capillaries and veins reflect, and then you think they have pink eyes, which is a myth. People who don't have pink eyes is a reflection of veins. So like my boss in Under the Same Sun has transparent eyes, and he looks pink in certain lighting. Most Africans, including myself, we're more gray. Gray, between gray, blue, hazel, green. Some have transparent as well, but that's more rare among African.
This is part of like a theoretical question, but like what you said about human rights doesn't apply as well to small groups of people. So, how do you think it could be reformulated to address that problem? So it would apply.
So thanks for bringing that up, because I think I kind of glossed over the fact that there is a convention on minorities, but it's very specific. It's convention on religious, ethnic, linguistic, and one more, forget. But so we didn't fit. So our best bet was disability, because of the disabilities we have. And you can argue we have multiple because of skin, eyes, attitude. But even though there's a convention on minorities, it still doesn't move you anywhere. Remember the Dalits I mentioned, the Indian Dalits. I never saw their issue get past a certain point at the UN. We always said hi to each other in the hallway, and I saw them trying to push. But without all these resources, strategic thinking, fighting the Battle of David, I just didn't see how. So there's protection in theory, but I think everything else comes into practice. Comes to a question of practice, and we don't always get taught that in school. We get taught the theory, but half of that is practicalities, strategies, playing chess, as I call it, literally playing chess.
Hi, I had a couple of questions. One on whether you could speak to rates of marriage of people with albinism, either with each other or with people without albinism in these countries, and also whether there is a singular stigma that you experience or that you monitor for people with vitiligo.
Vitiligo, yes. So I'll answer vitiligo first because it's simpler. I don't have much to say. So vitiligo, for those who don't know, you might have seen people who have patches of like white on their skin, more visible if the person has more melanin. Like it can be quite striking. People with vitiligo, it's an autoimmune condition. Unlike albinism, that's genetic. So vitiligo is like a medical issue, I can say. But its effect is disabling because they face attitudes, right? So in a sense, they while they have a health issue, they can also be looked at as people with disabilities. I didn't touch the issue per se, because for me, the priority was the attacks, the myths about albinism, which was people kind of understood vitiligo as in terms of in the ignorant communities, if I can use that word, they understood vitiligo as a health issue, because usually the person was born without it. But albinism, you were born like this from the get-go. So as soon as the child is coming out, the myths have started. The plans for infanticide have started. So it was more deeper. So I had to focus on that. And that was my mandate too. So. And then the other question you asked was about marriages. So yes, marriages can, between people with albinism have been reported. I have seen a case where people with albinism got married to each other and then they had the same type of albinism. So all their kids had albinism. And some people are adamant about that. They're like, the world has treated me poorly. I'm going to give the world more people with albinism until they realize that we're normal. There's a philosophical position. And then there's some that are like, I would never do that to my kid. What I went through was so hard. I would never. And they're looking for the darkest person to marry. And then there's a couple I saw who didn't have the same albinism. And then they give birth to a black child. And now the opposite thing happened. The woman got accused of cheating. The funny thing was the husband actually knew she did it. He's like, no, I know this is my baby. But yeah, we had to bring in a geneticist and to kind of got an email. He cried for help. We contacted geneticists here in America. He's one of the best in albinism. His name is Dr. Brilliant, by the way. So Dr. Brilliant got in and he's like, yeah, it's possible they have different types of albinism. That's how that issue got settled. Otherwise, another myth was coming out of that. But yeah, generally, if you carry the gene, you will pass it on to your children. Whether they have it or not depends on whether your husband also carries, or your spouse, or your other person carries the gene. Like, I don't know if that makes sense. It's a bit complex. Yeah?
I'm intrigued with the notion you brought up of witchcraft. Can you just touch a little bit more on that? And then I'm not sure if this is an appropriate question, but having experienced any association with witchcraft, and do you mean are like people who have albinism, are they being labeled that they are conditioned or their being is a result of witchcraft, or people are performing rituals or something on them? I'm just wondering if you can touch on that.
Okay, I'll try to answer it. If I don't, you'll let me know. So yes, the notion of witchcraft is a huge different presentation, because we had to go through that process of years training. What exactly is witchcraft? How do you define it? Is it something that you just read about in books, or is it the same as sorcery? And if it's not, what's the difference? Like, it's very academic and interesting. So in the end, we realized we can't define it, right? I'm just telling you this because there's actually no definition. What we settled on was this acronym that I had used called HPAWR, which means harmful practices associated with witchcraft and ritual effects. So anything that is associated with so-called witchcraft. So we decided, let's protect people without defining it, because at the end of the day, that takes us down the rabbit hole. And people just, it's enough for them to say, we thought it was for this purpose. We don't have to know what that purpose, like the witchcraft meant. We just have to know they associated the attack with that. So that's how we dealt with that issue. But in terms of my own personal experience with witchcraft, I haven't been attacked, only indirect comments. Like somebody once said to me, first time I went to Tanzania, and he said, oh, I didn't know people with albinism can have clear skin. Because they were at that point, like they literally were, most of them were covered in skin cancer, like sunburns or damage, yeah? So he was like, wow, that's interesting. I didn't know you could take this form, basically. And he's like, so this means like you're probably worth more for the witch doctors.
Wow.
Yeah, so that was the first time I was like, wow. I did tell my boss, and we like, yeah. So I started going with security to Tanzania, like a plain clothes person. And then the second time I felt uncomfortable was when, when I went to visit a village in Malawi, and I had seen them, and it was like 6 p.m. And according to you, the UN, you have to leave the rural area before it gets dark. But they were like, no, we have to talk to you. We have more cases. You have to spend the night. We have a hotel. And the hotel was kind of, And they were like, you should stay there. Like, there's been a lot of attacks in that village. I was like, No. It was the first time I actually felt bad, realizing that I was supporting people whose lives I couldn't take, right? Like, a part of me felt hypocritical because I knew I couldn't spend the night there. I just wanted to get out, and yet I was representing them. So it was the first time I felt uncomfortable. But I haven't ever been attacked, but then I'm a privileged person. UN had security with me all the time. I had security when I was not even in the UN. Nowadays, I've lost all those privileges, but I think I'll be okay. Yeah. I don't know if I answered your question. But, okay.
Oh. Do you know, in terms of the history, in terms of when that association with so-called witchcraft started to associate something of value with people with albinism?
No, I don't know when it happened. There's a lot of theories and speculations, and some countries had the opposite. The witch doctors or the king decided that albinism was actually a blessing, but those were a minority. Some indigenous groups here in the U.S. and in Panama also look at people with albinism as a blessing or children of the gods or children of the moon, they call them. I don't like any of that. I don't think we should be dehumanized. Neither do I think we should be supernaturalized. Because anybody who can take you up can bring you down. So leave us where we are, we're humans, like end of story, right? So, but generally the witch doctor plays a very crucial role in ancient indigenous communities, and they should be separated from herbalists who are different, they practice in medicine. But nowadays the herbalists started practicing witchcraft because witchcraft is more lucrative, it's magic. If I give you this, you'll get this, right? And for that, I charge you 10,000 currency. So a lot of herbalists are going into witchcraft practice. So it's very hard to trace back the origin of anything. What we know is that in the past, the witch doctor and the oracle person have defined albinism in ways that were not favorable, that led to deaths. Yeah. But nowadays, capitalism has confused a lot of things, because people now think capitalism is also witchcraft. So there's more going, because how do you get rich overnight? Of course you went to a witch doctor, and now people go to witch doctors to capitalize on things. So there's a huge, it's very confounding to trace anything, how it all started. I think it's multiple factors. One study by a UNICEF researcher called Simpric, last name C-I-M-P-R-I-C, she did a study in Tanzania, and her conclusion was this selling of body parts of people with albinism in Tanzania started when Tanzania went from socialism to capitalism. She traced it to that, yeah. Around the 90s, because people did not understand how you could go from sharing everything in a communal way, communism, to like that guy just became a millionaire. Like they didn't understand he now has shares in a mining company. They just thought he was a witch, he practiced witchcraft. And so many more people wanted to tap into that. That was their way of getting wealthy in capitalism. That was her theory. But lots of people have countered that.
Can you say her name again, please?
That's what I was gonna ask.
Alexandra Simpric. C-I-M-P-R-I-C.
Awesome. I apologize if I missed it, but have you seen much movies or TV shows, media, comics, anything to educate people about these issues in these countries?
Yeah, there's been a lot. That's why I said I couldn't list all the success stories. There's been a lot. I'm very grateful to people like you, like average people who have just been like, I want to do this, and then they do it. There's been a movie titled In the Shadow of the Sun that's actually on Netflix. Even more recent, just came out 2 months ago and was like one of the top movies on Netflix. It's called Can You See Us? I really like that one, Can You See Us? And then there was a movie that's, for instance, in NGOs like ours, what we had done was we made a movie called Black and White. It's not on Netflix, it was pre-Netflix. And we toured all the rural Tanzania with it. And a lot of people attribute that touring for 3 years to the decline that you could see around 2009 to 2011. There was a decline there. It was very expensive. Yeah, taking like outdoor cinemas, and then you get like performing artists to open up the stage. When they came, then thousands of people came because you're seeing your superstars on stage. Now you have 50,000 people, you've got them, and you just start doing the advocacy. So a lot of that was done in several countries. And I think they were quite successful. But you can watch those movies on Netflix.
And were these documentaries or were they features?
In the Shadow of the Sun is a documentary. Documentary, but docufilm, so it was there. Yeah? And then Can You See Us is a film feature based on a true life story of somebody still alive. Yeah.
Certainly in places like Latin America, they'll incorporate into like telenovelas or soap opera storylines that might feature a particular issue.
Yes.
And is that anything that's been pursued in these places?
It is, but very controversial. For instance, in South Africa, there is a girl who is in one of their soap operas. But in the soap opera, she's a woo-woo supernatural person. So a lot of people in Albinism are upset by that, whereas others are like, at least she got a job. So there's always this argument, like how much exposure is good exposure? I think most movements have this question, like what exposure is good exposure? But South America is a bit behind. Obviously, they're only now gathering. They have a regional group just formed 3 years ago. So they're only just rising. I don't know how far they've come. It could be that there's somebody and she's disguised, like hair color is dyed, wearing dyed eyebrows, very common, fake tan. So a lot of people who hide, even in America, there's documentaries on people with albinism disguising with colors just to have like a less stressful life, I suppose.
You made a statement earlier that I thought was interesting. Why do you think white people might feel more connected to the cause of albinism?
Relatability, like people can relate. I think there's a lot of social science studies. I can't quote any authors right now, but I do believe there's studies that I've seen showing that people relate to what has happened to them or to what might happen to them. So this is why you would find, for instance, there's a lot of empathy for white South Africans by white people because they can see themselves in that position. It's just human. Or like, you know, black people might in Canada might be offended at the George Floyd issue because they can see themselves in that. So human nature, unfortunately, is not studied as much as it used to be, but I think it's very valuable. Like, why wouldn't you study the units of your life and the units of your society? I find that very bizarre. Like, we used to have that in universities, but I think there's a fear of saying trends can predict a certain behavior and all that, but it's very important to see what binds us, what are those patterns that we human beings do together while studying the differences. Now there's an obsession with differences. Oh, we're all different. True, but at the same time, we're the same. And one of the things that we're the same on is we empathize with things that could happen to us. That's why you find more support for people who are elderly, right? Like the elder, they're trying to write a convention on people who are elderly. Lots of support for that. For disabilities, not so much, because people are like, I may not be disabled, why should I bother? Mm-hmm. So it's a thing of human nature, and we genuinely have to, it's an uphill battle. We have to fight against our nature sometimes to achieve what makes us more human and less just predictable animals.
When you mentioned the global north before, I guess being resistant to albinism being included as a disability, was that mostly people classified as white?
It was mostly people in the disability movement who were mostly from North America and South America. Yeah.
Was it a lot of white people?
Yes, a lot of ethnic people. Yes.
That's fascinating. Fascinating.
Didn't see any questions, so I'm going to ask one.
Sure.
Can you talk a little bit about the different regional networks? So obviously the Africa albinism network is quite strong, but you just mentioned that in Latin America, it's just getting organized. Can you kind of lay out maybe some of the different regions and what it is that either helped them coalesce or why you kind of feel they haven't come together? Like, I'm interested, is there representation in Europe? Is there representation in South Asia or in East Asia?
Okay. Well, that's a good question. This is why nowadays I was telling Stephen I'm transitioning out of the movement. I think anybody in activism should have an exit plan. Like, because you meet those people who've been in the movement like 50 years and you're like, wow. let other people do it. So one of my transition plan, I'm moving more into coaching people. Why? Because and this ties into your question, I'm not just trying to sell my coaching services. One issue is, I found like it's people, the leader makes a difference. They make a difference. We try to tell ourselves the opposite, but it's absolutely false, completely false. Actually, Gallup just published a book that was best-selling. It's called It's the Manager. And the book shows that 70% of the well-being of people at work depends on the manager. So I think the differences between those regions is leadership. So we who led the Africa network and also the UN advocacy. We were in an NGO, but we ran things like a business. Like there was no, give her a chance to be inclusive. We were inclusive in another way. So like I was explaining, I was telling Stephen, like we were an NGO, but we brought in a psychometrics testing. It's a testing of your temperament and a testing of your skill set. And this guy who ran the workshop is an ex-FBI agent, came from California. And he did like a mapping of everybody's skill set based on this test. And we could all see who could do what better. And then we talked about it and we're comfortable with, okay, so you and you are skilled at advocacy. So you're going to do most of it. Is that okay with you? You and you. And so we work with all of that, really. And yes, resources is a difference between the region, but I would say leadership. Sometimes people don't realize I'm not the best at this. I should let somebody else. Mm. And then they become the downfall of their own movement. So I think that's no small thing when it comes to movements, but leaders should be self-aware and have the humility to know when to bring in a mosaic of helpers. So the differences I see mostly is in leadership and secondary resources.
Okay.
Do you have an estimate on the global population of individuals with albinism?
We counted based on the rough estimate studies that are around, and we're looking at about 1 million. It's very small.
Okay.
Okay, we have a question.
Do you think that along with, I agree with you that the issue of leadership is definitely really important. Sometimes people don't realize that even if they want to do leadership, it might not be the best for the role. And your system sounds like it was phenomenal. But do you think that maybe also the fact that the attacks in Africa seem to be especially jarring may have been helpful as a catalyst to bring that region kind of to the forefront and make that community more kind of visible, especially since we're talking about a community that's like small, right? It's a minority, like it's not being pulled to the forefront by the disability community because they believe that like we should focus on issues that unite us and not issues that like put any one specific community to the forefront, which is ridiculous. But it seems like when you have something that is like especially jarring or especially kind of like urgent feeling, that might help create a little bit of a catalyst. And if you don't have something similar happening in other regions, that might leave them a little bit behind.
Absolutely. At number three, I acknowledge one of the caveats in replicating what we did is we had a sense of urgency. Mm.
I don't know
if everybody will have that. But I believe after working with so many business people trying to do non-business work is that you can find a selling point in humanity. You always will. Even if nobody are being attacked, there will always be issues you can sell. Like women, always. Sexual assault with women, which unfortunately is always tends not to go down. Children. Yeah, so I feel there's always a selling point. It just has to be, we have to be strategic. That's what I mentioned about playing chess. Many more leaders need coaching. I think we were coached, and that's why I feel I can help people to do that, because they have it, they just haven't thought about the pieces that way, in a way that would put them in a stronger position.
And so, for example, when aligning yourself with like the disability movement seemed to not be working because they felt like putting your movement to the forefront was actually sowing discord instead of solidarity, which again, ridiculous. But when that happened, you guys realized that was just not where it was going to be. So you just went, put that to the side and found a alliance elsewhere.
That's right. That's right. The funny thing is we found people with disabilities willing to take the risk with us. So this is something else I didn't have a chance to say. We have to find like-minded people. Mm-hmm. If you're strategic, you must work with other strategic people. Mm-hmm. I had a UN officer from Colombia who was an absolute hero for us. She's mm-hmm. still in the UN, by the way. And many times inside, she would do things for us or find a way to get things done. Mm-hmm. And when I told her about the disabilities movement, I'm like, hey, the guy is saying this, this. She's like, don't worry, they'll meet us there. Let's go. So you need somebody who has that daring. Mm-hmm. And we tend not to realize how much of that, like, I mean, George Washington and all your founding fathers and people, their daring was like it's world renowned. And we always downplay those things, not realizing that it is a huge strength. And many people won't go anywhere without that.
Yeah. I think it's remarkable that instead of getting caught up fighting with the disability people about why they should prioritize you, you were like, okay, and
no,
we'll just find somewhere else.
That's right. Pick your battles. Like, our energy was very little. Why fight? Yeah.
Remarkable.
But now we're cool. Like, they invite me to all the parties.
All right. Do we have any last questions?
Can I just make a quick comment? Because I don't know that you had asked about, are you legally blind? Just to say that it's very tricky with albinism. So right now, I have contact lenses. With contact lenses, I'm not legally blind right now.
Okay.
At night, when I take it off, I become legally blind.
Wow.
So, just thought I should clarify that.
Okay. Well, thank you so much.
Thank you.
This is fantastic. Thank you.
Yeah. Nigga, you're so brainwashed.
I'm a victim,
no
brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
Yeah. I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my conditioning.
Mm-hmm.
Even my conditioning has been conditioned.